Hello, my name is Reema, and welcome again to the second edition of what I call now the Quarantimes. This is a series of interviews that we are conducting with women entrepreneurs across India who are leading different businesses. The idea is to understand in these challenging times of lockdown and the spread of coronavirus, what is the impact that this lockdown is having on their business and what are they doing to manage the risk. With me today, I have Divya Medar. She is the owner and director of SnackerStreet Private Limited. SnackerStreet makes ready-to-cook frozen snacks and company. Divya, welcome to the conversation.
Hi, Reema. Thanks a lot for having me.
So, Divya, maybe for our listeners who are not familiar with SnackerStreet, maybe you can describe a little bit more about your business. What do you do? What is the operation scale like? And a little bit more how long you've been in operations.
Sure. The background is that I'm a chef, and so is my husband and partner Gopinath. Both of us kind of started this business in 2009. We started with momos, which are steamed dumplings. And from there, we became a frozen snacks company, which is a different story altogether. We had a lot of tough challenges. And today we are a frozen snacks company supplying pan-India to quite a few large chains and some unicorns as well. We make ready-to-cook frozen snacks without added preservatives using fresh ingredients, which is an innovative practice in the industry, which is used to a lot of highly processed ingredients. So this is what kind of sets us apart. We have been in this business since 2009. So we have a distribution and dealer model pan-India, and I employ about 40 people, including my office and sales team and my production staff.
I have tried your momos once, so I know how tasty they are. Are food items considered essential services?
I think there's a conundrum there, and it's interesting that you bring that up. If you ask me, food in no matter what form is an essential product, whether it's frozen or fresh or, highly perishable such as dairy. Especially under such lockdown periods, I would consider that frozen does become essential because it ensures you don't step out of the house. You can ensure that you're stocked enough for the 21 days and put the stuff in the freezer, and it ensures you have a good snack and nutritious snack as well. So I would consider frozen food to be essential, yes. And the government has now thankfully allowed the movement of essential and non-essential goods under the lockdown period also.
Sure. So under the government now, it is considered an essential food. Is that what I'm hearing from you?
I would say that it's not yet clear, but yes, I think overall food does come under essential. So yes, but there is no specific mandate regarding frozen produce.
Sure. So maybe let's explore that a little bit, because part of the conversation is around the impact on business, right? And of course, the spread of coronavirus has been so huge and so fast that a lot of countries are struggling to deal with it. In India, the government has taken very proactive measures. They have a 21 days lockdown. And, we have barred all incoming international flights. A lot of trains have stopped. And though it's good from a health perspective, the economic perspective is completely different, right? And so a lot of people are anxious. A lot of temp workers, we see the migrant labor force issue that has cropped up in a lot of urban areas. No one knows how long this lockdown will be. There are talks, although we have a date of April 14th, I think that's when the three-week period gets over. But a lot of people are talking about extension of those lockdowns. So in this environment of uncertainty, and I'm sure you mentioned you have about 40 workers and you have a factory. And are they anxious? Have you had to lay off? Have you had to make difficult decisions? How are you handling this? Of your employees?
So let me kind of answer that a bit differently. I think business is, it's a process of value creation, and looking at it with a myopic, view of the corona situation, I think it's a really short-term approach. Yes, but in saying that, these are unprecedented times, and there is a lot of ambiguity, a lot of uncertainty, a lot of valid as well as misplaced anxiety. In such times, I think communication is the key, as it is always. I think in terms of, when you mentioned my team, I think stakeholders are key to any business, be it, employees or your suppliers, or in companies such as myself, the distributors and sub-dealers. So I think this is a key time. And in fact, we have the time to kind of virtually engage and kind of allay their fears. I think for employees, if you say that, yes, the salaries, in fact, we are paying salaries on time, and telling them that it will be paid, because that is a basic need of the hour. Their domestic expenses would have gone up under such lockdown circumstances. So telling them that would kind of ensure that, they are here to stay. Apart from that, engaging the sales team, I think, is extremely critical, which is something that we are doing. We have kind of encouraged them to kind of build capacities and knowledge. We have shared certain online courses which they can do during this time to kind of do that. Apart from that, building a customer database using online resources, which is something everybody has access to today. And apart from that, kind of revamping the sales plan for the new financial year, because this kind of lockdown, like you rightly said, yes, it is up to April 14th. And even if the lockdown is lifted, these are uncertain times. In fact, when it comes to production also, we don't know whether, the demand would kind of suddenly go up as soon as the lockdown is lifted, because there will be a lot of events, or we don't know whether there will still be a continued fear and the events would not happen. Hence, we don't know whether to kind of produce more or kind of lay low. I think we need to kind of, like I said, keep our eye on the future. Set the ball rolling. It requires us to keep the purpose in mind, what we set out to do, and ensure that we are communicating the right message to all the stakeholders. In fact, just yesterday, I kind of had a video call. I had a call with my sales head, and he was saying, let's do a call with all the distributors, which I had asked him to do. I said, no, let's do a video call, because even in such times, especially when there is a lot of uncertainty, it's good to have a human touch. Yes, it's still virtual, but at least you're able to see the person. So, and I think that was in fact received very, very positively. So we kind of discussed what are the issues and, their personal issues as well as their business issues. And we shared a lot of ideas. And sometimes the best ideas come out of, like I always say, out of sometimes the most surprising places. So, in such times, I think, like I said, keep the eye on the future, and we all have to dig our feet firmly into the ground and grit our teeth and kind of tide it out.
No, thank you so much. I totally agree with you. I think for the points that you mentioned, is communication is key. My second question to you is about, there are a lot of challenges that businesses, especially small and medium enterprise, face is managing cash flows, right? In regular times as well, it is a challenge, especially if your supply chain is disrupted or if customer payments are disrupted in any sense. And especially in these challenging times, the challenge would be double. Because, sometimes you have a lot of accounts receivables and your customers are facing equally dire situation in terms of getting payments from their sales. So for them to pay you, and especially I think if you look at restaurant business, which I would assume is your customers, and the hotel business, if they are facing a dire situation, for them to be able to pay you would be a challenge. The second thing is, of course, you have your suppliers who are also counting on you to pay, and so that they can make their payments in turn. So it's a catch-22 cycle, right? And the idea is, maybe you can share a little bit about what your business is facing. Are there some initiatives that you have taken that others, who are listening to a conversation probably can take into account? And if there are some mitigation strategies that you're doing to be able to, allay fear.
Sure, Reema. I think, you know, it is, I think, the question and need of the hour, especially when it comes to MSMEs. I think liquidity is paramount because cash flows from month to month. And even if 1 month you kind of, if it comes to a halt like it has now, sales has come to a grinding halt and cash flow has stopped across the entire sales cycle. You know, even if you look at from our angle, if you look at the hospitality sector, hotels, caterers, event management companies, they've cancelled all their events, weddings, etc. And right now, like you rightly mentioned earlier, there is so much ambiguity that we don't know. And there's a lot of fear also. So we don't know really when, you know, this is going to go up. And if it is going to go up, possibly it might happen at a very small scale, the events. Hence, you know, April also, we kind of, April and May also, we are kind of expecting a slowdown. And I think the economic impact, I believe in my humble opinion, would be there for at least 12 to 18 months. While the government has kind of helped MSMEs and the industries on the loan installment sides and in deferred statutory payments, our burn rates in terms of you know, water charges, electricity, salaries, etc., which are huge components for MSMEs, especially you know, that may, contributes a major chunk of the cash outflow. This will kind of strain our finances and you know, it will erode our long-term source of funds. So, as part of you know, a risk mitigation measure to kind of ensure that you know, we meet all our commitments, even if the business takes time to kind of recover, we have raised money from within family and extended sources to kind of you know, do that. We have also kind of applied to the bank for extended working capital limits. Of course, the bank is also very minimally staffed, so they are kind of taking time to get back on this. But I think, you know, like I mentioned earlier, we have to have our eye on the future and do what we have to. So in terms of suppliers, we have paid, you know, the smaller stakeholders who would, you know, need it more than the larger ones. With the larger suppliers, we have kind of communicated for a fact that this time payments would be kind of delayed because of the situation. But we have made part payments in, you know, to the perishable food suppliers such as dairy. I think, however, if you look at the overall business, I think the e-business is thriving. So I think we should also look at this as an opportunity to kind of pivot and change our business model. If you look at it, online businesses such as e-delivery, dark kitchens, dark stores, gaming, these are all businesses which are actually doing much better business today because it requires, it's kind of engaging with people who are kind of stuck at home and, you know, confined for long periods of time. So I think this is a chance that we are looking at to kind of a partner with a lot of online chains. And we have been successfully able to do that. We're going to start business within the next week with a very large online unicorn. So I think this is something that we have made the best of. From our internal perspectives, I think we kind of need to have a very, very strict planning on cash flows. We need to understand how much cash we have in hand, when can we expect the next kind of funds to flow in, and then kind of plan it down to the rupee and ensure that, you know, if there are going to be any delays, you kind of communicate that because everybody is facing ambiguity. At least they know that, you know, yes, it's coming, but this is the date that when it's going to come. So it helps them to plan as well. I think, yes, there are people who kind of there are always opportunists. There have been so-called people who have kind of capitalized on this and delayed even February payments. You know, I think we have to, like I said, make the most and, you know, dig our feet down and kind of tide it through.
Sure. That, I think you brought in some very good points. I mean, of course, it's a coronavirus and the lockdown is a very dark cloud. But there is a silver lining. There are new business models or new opportunities. And I think what you mentioned, I just received my big basket delivery actually today after this whole lockdown period. And it's great to see them back up. And I totally agree with you that maybe from your perspective, that's a channel that you can exploit more and investigate more. And I think the points that you made, again, communication is key, even with your suppliers and vendors and your customers, and kind of trying to, I think the point that you made is you're prioritizing, right? Which are your suppliers that can hopefully extend you a little bit more credit, extend you a little bit more leeway versus small suppliers who are themselves living day to day? How can you ensure that you can do payments? And I think micromanaging your cash flows, right? Because at this point in time, you have certain amount of cash at hand and you have to really manage that very, very finely because you know, it's not just a month or 21 days. It's going to be an extended, at least you're looking at a 2 to 3 month time horizon. So I think great points. Maybe the next point I do want to explore a little bit more is what you had mentioned a little bit from the government perspective. The good news is I think Indian government, as I see it, has been very proactive just after Narendra Modi announced the lockdown. 2 days after that, the finance minister announced a slew of policies and schemes that will hopefully allay some of the fears that we have with respect to the economy, especially for small and medium enterprises, as well as individuals. The whole idea was this deferment of loans, right? So any loan you might have, it's deferred for 3 months. You don't need to make interest payments right now or principal payments. So no payments, outlays need to be put out for the next 3 months. There have been other similar schemes for GST filing and delaying of the filings, tax filings, and so on and so forth. My question to you as a business owner is, of course, is that enough? Does this, because as you said, right, you do have fixed costs for which you have to make payments. And the government also mentioned that they are giving more liquidity to the banks. The RBI itself has put out a whole bunch of measures, so banks have more money to lend to others. And you mentioned, I mean, of course, there's a challenge right now because banks also are not working at full scale. So when you ask them for clarification, maybe there's no one at the other end to answer your query. But do you feel these schemes are enough? Are there certain areas where you feel government, you expect the government to do more?
I think that's a great question, Reema. I think this is a time that I definitely, as an MSME, I think on behalf of the MSMEs, at least we can acknowledge proactive support from the government in terms of all the schemes that you rightly mentioned, like the moratorium on loan installments, especially. But how do MSMEs who are tight on cash flows, who do not have the the bandwidth to or luxury of huge cash flows, how do we kind of service our rent, electricity, water, salaries, and without actually having any income? So we need to look at encouraging the banks to lend a long-term working capital facility to cover the 3 months of fixed expenses that is repayable over a longer period. I think also if you look at MSMEs, they're one of the largest contributors to both the GDP as well as exports. If you look at the kind of liquidity infused into the economy today, it is less than 1%. If you look at a country or like US, where they have under the current situations, they've infused up to 5% of their GDP. I think keeping this in mind, I would urge the government although yes, they have taken measures by reducing the CRR by 100 basis points, they've done a lot of stuff, but I think more measures to improve liquidity, the liquidity situation is definitely required. So, what if you need loans above 1 crore under the current situation, because it is a good time to kind of invest in the future, to hire and, build, capacities. So what if you need loans above this? Today, banks in both private and public sector do not consider machinery as security, but would lend against hypothecation of such assets. Only if you have collateral. What if we do not have collateral? How do we manage this? And if you want to kind of move over, then you expect to, you're expected to pay off the entire loan. How do you manage under such situations? These are real ground level situations or ground level issues that kind of need to be addressed, which are much more grave considering the current scenario. MSMEs also, do not get equity funding easily. The banks should definitely set up an equity funding window and invest in select good companies with which are showing promise and lend without insisting on collateral security. So I think in terms of two things, one is the working capital requirement as well as the long-term investment point of view. I think this is something which I would urge the government to do. But in saying all that, I of course do acknowledge their proactive support. But it has to be much more.
Yeah. No, I agree. I think two points that you make which are very valid, and I think maybe the government needs to consider that, hey, this is a time also for businesses and organizations to see how they want to reorganize themselves, what new investments they want to make, capital, and if it is capital investment, the requirement is much more. And I think, like you were talking about, right, it's not just a three-month window. You want to look at least a year horizon for working capital that you will need, because it's not like the business will come up immediately and will start back at the levels that you left off, right? There is going to be a ramp up period. There is going to be a lot of uncertainty. Maybe there'll be new schemes, new projects that you will have to do to kind of build back the customer confidence and to
absolutely
help that, you need that infusion of capital. So I think this is a good starting point, as we would agree upon, but there needs to be much more. And the second point you made is that, it's very good that the government has a lot of schemes, but the implementation of those schemes is equally important. And, even though the banks might be flush with cash or have enough liquidity, the question is, are you seeing that impact when you go as an MSME to ask for loans? And, if they're still asking for collaterals and still asking for a lot of your business balance sheet, and based on that, they give you funding and they look at the last few months and you find that it's not there, then it defeats the purpose, right? So implementation is key. I think the last question I had for you was, of course, from a business side, there's a huge impact. And of course, I think the good news is, because you are an entrepreneur, you're in it for the long term. You believe in the products and the value that you're creating. And that's why you feel like you can tide over this hard times and hopefully this short-lived. So Divya, my last question to you is from a woman's perspective. I've been hearing from foreign media that cases of domestic violence and abuse against women has increased. On the home front too, many women are facing the stress of juggling family and work without the usual house help. I know you're involved with many organizations that focus on women empowerment, like IWN and others. Have you heard any stories that should be a cause of concern for us within the Indian context? What are your thoughts? Are you also struggling to balance between your business and home?
Issue is very real. In fact, I was having a very detailed conversation with Ekta Verma of Invisible Scars yesterday, and she was just mentioning, that actually, and it's not just limited to domestic abuse. There is so many other types of abuse. There is, there's absolute depression. There is a lot of anxiety. There are elderly people who are lacking any kind of medical aid, and in fact, a person known to her just kind of passed away a few days ago because of that. There is a lot of psychological abuse as well happening at the moment, and there is no place to reach out to because you're confined within the four walls. There are patients who are mentally ill, who say suffering from schizophrenia or bipolar disorder, and she says they are unable to access medicine. Now, I don't know in which part of the country they are. I mean, luckily, the government has mandated 24/7 opening of this thing, but I guess they don't have people to kind of go out and get it, right? So where are the e-delivery services now? So I think, yes, coming down to the more mundane stuff, I think women are having to juggle a lot more because you can't just, complete your housework and then go to office. You're having to do everything from home. And many of us don't have office setups at home, right? We've never done a work from home. A lot of us have never done work from home before. So kind of having to juggle and fight for that space where you can do your work as well as, ensure you're sticking to your kind of office routine and discipline is a challenge. And I think for women especially, the challenge is a lot bigger than it seems, because you have children running in the background, you have elderly people who are talking, and then you have, in between all that, you have the webinars and video chats, and it's pretty chaotic. So I think this is the time to kind of, like I said, communication is the key. You need to kind of engage your family stakeholders and kind of, you know, tell them that, you know, this is the time I need you to be locked inside a room and, you know, I need to kind of complete this work and, you know, show that this work is important to you and say that, you know, yes, I'll make only this today. There's not going to be a feast on the table and, you know, just like it is any normal office day. And I say, in related to the medical stuff, I think, you know, kudos to all the medical team out there. And I wish the government would do more. We are, in fact, hopefully planning to engage with a couple of people from IWN, and IWN is planning to engage with a couple of people outside kind of create a helpline for these kind of cases. So let's see where it goes. Hopefully people will come together as they always do. And, you know, we would do something good will come out of this.
Sure. Awesome. Thank you, Divya. It's been a pleasure talking to you.